عباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما.
Indeed, all praises to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His aid, and we ask His forgiveness. We seek the refuge of Allah from the evils of ourselves and the evils of our deeds. Whomever Allah guides, none can misguide. Whomever Allah misguides, none can guide. And I bear witness and testify that there's no God worthy of worship except for Allah, alone without partners, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is His slave and His final messenger. We proceed with us today by the praise of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Is Fadilat al-Shaykh Khalid Ismail, hafidhahu Allah ta'ala. And the Shaykh, may Allah reward him tremendously, has agreed to address us tonight on the topic of Al-Iman. And the lecture is titled, The Tree of Iman. And we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to reward the Shaykh greatly for the time and effort that he is expending to teach and share the knowledge with his brothers and sisters from the community of Masjid Ibad al-Rahman and all those who are joining us today. نسأل الله الشيخ التوفيق والسداد والعون وأن ينفع بما يقول وأن ينفعنا وسائر إخواننا بما نسمع. فليتفضل الشيخ مشكورا.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله.
Shaykh, may Allah reward him again. Indeed, all praises to Allah. May the exaltations of Allah be upon His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, and I testify that there is no God worthy of worship besides Allah, and that Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is His slave and His Messenger.
في البداية أشعر في الحقيقة بفرح عظيم أني في هذه الكلمة أتكلم مع إخواني وأخواتي من المسلمين والمسلمات في أمريكا، وبيننا وبينهم هذا البعد الشاسع، ولكن هذا من نعمة الله علينا كما جمعنا الله تعالى في هذه المحاضرة. أسأل الله تعالى أن يجمعنا عنده في الفردوس الأعلى.
JazakAllah khairan. He said, to begin, I want to express the joy that I am feeling, tremendous happiness that I'm speaking to my brothers and sisters from the Muslimin in America, and that despite these tremendous or vast distances between us, Allah Jalla wa Ala, by His blessing, has gathered us for this lecture. And I ask Him, just as He did so, that He gather us in Al-Jannah. Ameen. Fadlu wa shukr.
وأسأل الله تعالى أن يجعل هذا اللقاء لقاء خالصا لوجه الكريم وأن يزيدنا به إيمانا وقربا من ربنا جل وعلا.
The Shaykh said, I ask Allah to make this gathering of ours one that is sincerely seeking the face of Allah جل وعلا. One that causes an increase in our faith and closeness to our Lord.
الإنسان إذا رأى المناظر الجميلة من الأشجار والثمار والزهور يتعجب من جمالها ويفرح قلبه بها، ولكن هناك شجرة أجمل من كل الأشجار في الدنيا، ألا وهي شجرة الإيمان التي سنتحدث عنها اليوم.
A person sees splendid views, beautiful scenery, the like of trees and flowers and fruits. Sometimes he is amazed by the splendor of what he's seeing, and his heart becomes filled with joy at the beauty of the scenery that he is witnessing. However, there is a tree that is more beautiful than any of the trees of this dunya. And it is the tree of faith, the tree that we are going to be speaking about tonight.
وجميل بالمسلم أن يتفكر في مخلوقات الله ويربط بينها وبين أمور الدين، وهذا نجده في القرآن الكريم. فكما أننا نرى شجرة جميلة في الدنيا، فالله جل وعلا مثل أو شبه الإيمان بالشجرة الطيبة.
جزاه الله خير. السؤال and it behooves a Muslim, it is beneficial for him to ponder over the creation of Allah and to attempt to link between that which he observes of the creation of Allah and that which he learns from the religion of Allah. This is a methodology that the Quran teaches. Just as we see beautiful trees in this worldly life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the analogy for the faith with a tree in the Quran.
ولهذا ثبت عن أبي العالية رحمه الله وهو من التابعين ممن رأى الصحابة رضي الله عنهم أنه ذهب مع بعض أصحابه إلى أنس بن مالك خادم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رضي الله عنه، وكان هذا في الصباح، فقدم لهم أنس رضي الله عنه وجبة الإفطار كانت عبارة عن رطب، فقال لأبي العالية ومن معه، قال كل من هذا الرطب فإن هذا من الشجرة التي قال الله تعالى عنها في كتابه: ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء.
For this reason, we say it has been authentically narrated that Abu al-Aliya, and he is from the Tabi'een, from the students of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, a man who met with and seen the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He went with some of his companions to visit Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, the well-known companion who used to be the servant of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this was in the time of mourning. So he presented them al-iftar, the breakfast meal, and it was composed of rutab, soft, moist dates. And he said to them, Anas radiallahu anhu, eat from this, for this is from the tree that Allah jalla wa ala said about it. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً شَجَرَةً طَيِّبَةً أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. نترجم الآية شيخنا.
لا، سأفسر الآية إن شاء الله.
السلام عليكم.
لكن سبحان الله، تأملوا في هذا الأثر الجميل، كيف أن أنس رضي الله عنه عندما قدم لهم الرطب ذكرهم بالنخلة التي ضرب الله تعالى بها مثل الإيمان في القرآن. وهكذا كما قلت، المؤمن في هذه الدنيا دائما يتفكر، لا يرى شيئا إلا ويتفكر فيه ويربطه بمعاني الإيمان وأمور الدين.
The Shaykh Zahla Khairan, he said, ponder with me how Anas radiallahu anhu attempted to link what they were observing, what they were enjoying in this breakfast from the amenities of Allah, from His provisions, with the palm tree that Allah mentioned in the Quran. And this analogy that Allah Azza Jal gave us in the Quran is one of those types of examples we were talking about, that it is befitting of a believer to ponder over, always looking around at the creation of Allah, attempting to link that with what Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed in this religion.
وتعالوا نستمع لهذه الآية في القرآن الكريم، وكيف أن الله تعالى يشبه الإيمان بهذه الشجرة الطيبة. يقول الله تعالى: ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة، يعني كلمة التوحيد لا إله إلا الله، كلمة الإيمان، كشجرة طيبة، مثل الشجرة الطيبة وهي النخلة. قال: أصلها ثابت، النخلة أصلها ثابت، جذورها ثابتة قوية في الأرض، وفرعها في السماء، فروعها عالية في السماء، تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها. النخلة يخرج منها الرطب، يأكله الناس رطبا، ثم أيضا يستمر هذا الرطب فييبس، الناس يبسونه فيجعلونه تمرا ويأكلونه خلال السنة كلها، فلا تنقطع بركتها ولا تنقطع ثمرتها في كل العام.
جزاه الله خيرا. He said, let us now listen to this verse in which Allah Azza wa Jal likens this tree to a word, a goodly word. Allah Jalla wa Ala said, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. Have you not seen how Allah has drawn an analogy? The analogy here is كلمة طيبة, a goodly word, like a goodly tree, whose roots are firm, meaning that they are in the ground and they are strong and they're powerful, and it remains standing. فرعها في السماء, and its branches are in the heavens. It gives off its fruits at all times. Consider the palm tree that produces الرطب, and these are the soft and moist dates. And then these rutab, over time, when people dry them, they turn into dry dates. And then these dry dates can be stored and used throughout the year. So the benefit of this tree continues throughout the time of the year.
وشجرة الإيمان هكذا ثابتة بجذورها في قلب المسلم بالإخلاص لله ومحبة الله وخشية الله، الأعمال القلبية أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء. هذه الشجرة شجرة الإيمان فروعها في السماء، يعني الفروع الأعمال الصالحة، إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه. ثم شجرة الإيمان تثمر الثمار الطيبة، تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها، وهذا يعني بركة الإيمان من الأقوال النافعة، من الكلام الطيب، من ذكر الله، ومن الأخلاق الحسنة للمسلم.
Sheikh Jazakallah Khairan, he said, likewise, in the heart of the believer, this tree of faith is also firm. Its roots are firm. The roots are the actions of the heart, such as sincerity, loving Allah, fearing Allah. These are roots. أصلها ثابت. Its foundations are firm. وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ, and its branches are in the heavens. These are the good deeds that result from a heart that is of this description. The good deeds that ascend to Allah عز وجل. As Allah said, إِلَيْهِ يَصْعَدُ الْكَلِمُ الطَّيِّبُ وَالْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ يَرْفَعُ. To him ascend the good deeds and the goodly words. He raises them. And then it bears its fruits. تُؤْتِي أُكُلَهَا. It bears its fruits, as Allah has just said. These fruits are beneficial statements, goodly words, good manners, the like.
قد يقول قائل: ما الفائدة من هذا المثل في القرآن الكريم؟ ولماذا يشبه الله تعالى الإيمان بالشجرة؟
Perhaps someone will say, what is the benefit of this analogy that is found in the Quran? And why is Allah likening faith to a tree?
الجواب: حتى نزداد معرفة بحقيقة الإيمان.
The answer is so that we can come to see the truth of the reality of faith.
ونرى جمال الإيمان كما نرى جمال الأشجار في الدنيا.
So that we can come to see the beauty of the faith, just as we see the beauty and splendor of trees in this worldly life.
ونعرف كيف يزيد الإيمان ويحيا في قلوبنا.
So that we can come to learn how is it exactly that faith becomes enlivened and increases and grows in our hearts.
كما نحافظ على حياة الشجرة في الدنيا.
Exactly how we keep the trees alive and we take care of them in this worldly life.
ولذلك نستفيد من هذا المثل أن المؤمن في هذه الدنيا ينبغي عليه أن يحرص على أمرين عظيمين.
For this reason, we benefit from this analogy that a believer in this world must be very keen, very careful about two matters.
الأمر الأول أن يحرص على زيادة إيمانه ويتعاهد
First of all,
إيمانه. هل يزيد إيمانك أو ينقص إيمانك؟
first of these two matters is that a Muslim, a believer, should be very keen on watching over his faith and being aware of the fact, is it growing or is it decreasing? And he should be mindful of its status.
وهل إيمانك حيا؟ هل قلبك حيا بالإيمان أو قلبك ميت خال عن الإيمان؟
And is your heart alive? Is your faith alive? Is it that you have a living heart that is filled with faith, or is the heart dead?
لأن الشجرة عندما تزرع أي شجرة أولا تريد أن تحافظ على حياتها، فتتعاهد هذه الشجرة كيف تحافظ على حياتها بأن تسقي هذه الشجرة بين الفترة والفترة.
Because when it comes to a tree, when you plant a tree, your primary objective is to keep it alive. This is by watering it, supplying it with water at certain intervals to ensure that it remains alive.
وهكذا المؤمن يسقي إيمانه دائما حتى ينمو إيمانه ويزداد إيمانه.
And this is exactly the affair of the believer. He is always watering his faith, so to speak, and being mindful of it, keeping a watchful eye over it to make sure it is always in a state of growth.
والأمر الثاني الذي ينبغي للمسلم أن يحرص عليه عندما يزرع المزارع الشجرة ويسقيها، أيضا يلاحظ أن بجانب الشجرة قد تكون هناك نباتات ضارة تضر الشجرة أو حشرات مؤذية، فإذا تركها ربما تموت هذه الشجرة وتيبس. وهكذا المسلم ينبغي أن يحذر من الأمور التي تنقص إيمانه وربما تؤدي إلى قسوة قلبه.
And the second thing that a Muslim must be mindful of is just like when a farmer plants a tree, he is mindful of other trees or plants or vegetation that grows around it that is parasitic in nature or aggressive, such that it can harm his tree, or insects that are considered harmful to it and can cause it to become diseased or kill it. Likewise, the believer should be mindful of his faith and the things that decrease his faith or perhaps even lead to the hardness of his heart.
إذن ينبغي علينا أن نحرص على أسباب زيادة الإيمان حتى نسقي إيماننا دائما فيزداد إيماننا يوما بعد يوم.
It is for this reason that we must all become very concerned with and keen on the matters that cause the faith to grow in order for us to water our faith, so to speak, so that our faith is always in a state of growth day after day.
وأصل الإيمان في القلب بتوحيد الله والإخلاص له ومحبة الله وخشيته جل وعلا، فهذه الأعمال القلبية لا بد أن نسقيها حتى تقوى هذه الأعمال في القلوب كما تقوى جذور الشجرة فتكون شجرة قوية.
Sheikh said, and the foundation of faith in the heart is deeds like al-ikhlas, sincerity. And actually, the Sheikh started with tawheed, monotheism, Islamic monotheism, and then he said sincerity, then love, then fear. These are the deeds of the heart that we have to water, we have to feed them so that they become stronger, firmer. And this is exactly what is in the analogy, how the roots of that tree with continuous care become more powerful and stronger and hold it together.
ومن أعظم ما يسقي القلب بالإيمان هذه الصلوات الخمس.
And from the greatest of things that water this faith and supply it with its nourishment are these five daily prayers.
وتأملوا كيف أن الله تعالى جعلها في أوقات مختلفة، كما
And
أن
ponder how
الشجر
Allah And ponder how Allah Azza wa Jalla has made these prayers at different times.
كما أن الشجرة تحتاج إلى سقي في أوقات مختلفة، لو سقيناها في يوم وتركناها أياما ممكن تيبس وتموت، ولو تركناها في بعض الأيام ثم سقيناها في آخر اليوم يمكن أن تيبس، لكن الذي يسقي الشجرة دائما في وقت إلى وقت فتنمو هذه الشجرة وتقوى جذورها. وهكذا الصلوات الخمس، يأتي وقت الصباح ثم الظهر ثم العصر ثم المغرب ثم العشاء، كلما ضعف الإيمان تأتي هذه الصلوات وترجع المسلم إلى ربه وتزيد إيمانه.
جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and this is the analogy of a tree that is being watered at intervals. Imagine if a tree was watered in abundance and then left for days without any water. How would its affair be? Perhaps this tree would dry out and die. Or the opposite, that it was left to dry out for several days in succession, and then finally it was given water. Perhaps the same affair would end up that it would be dry and die. However, Allah Azza wa Jal has made it that the tree of faith is being watered by these prayers, supplied by these prayers with nourishment at intervals regularly. You begin with Salat al-Fajr, and then at an interval, you water it again, you nourish it again with Salat al-Zuhr. And then after an interval, Salat al-Asr. And then another interval, Salat al-Maghrib. And then finally, the last interval with Salat al-Isha.
ولذلك الله تعالى سمى الصلاة إيمانا. قال الله تعالى لما حولت القبلة من بيت المقدس إلى الكعبة، سأل بعض الصحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عمن صلى إلى بيت المقدس ومات قبل أن يصلي إلى الكعبة، هل ضاعت صلاتهم؟ فأنزل الله تعالى وما كان الله ليضيع إيمانكم، تأملوا، ما قال وما كان الله ليضيع صلاتكم، بل قال وما كان الله ليضيع إيمانكم. فالصلاة هي حقيقة الإيمان.
And ponder here how Allah has named the prayers faith. Allah called the daily prayers faith. And this is found in the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal that was revealed in the Quran when the famous story about the changing of the Qibla occurred. When the Qibla was shifted from Baytul Maqdis to Al-Kaaba, some of the Sahaba wondered and they asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam if the prayers that had been prayed towards Baytul Maqdis are now invalid and no longer count with Allah. So Allah jalla wa ala revealed, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. And surely Allah would not let your faith go to waste. The Shaykh said, notice how Allah said your faith go to waste instead of saying your prayers go to waste, meaning that Allah has named these prayers faith.
لأن حقيقة الصلاة محبة لله ودخول على الله جل وعلا.
Because the reality of the prayer is that it is love for Allah. It is an act of entering or visiting with Allah.
كشف نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم عن حقيقة الصلاة فقال إن أحدكم إذا قام يصلي فإنما يناجي ربه. ومعنى المناجاة يعني كلام العبد القريب لسيده. فالصلاة فيها قرب من الله، وكأنك دخلت على الله ووقفت أمامه فتكلمه كلام العبد القريب المحب.
Our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has exposed the reality of the prayer. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if one of you stands in prayer, then surely he is having a private, or if you wish, intimate, or if you wish, close conversation with Allah. This is the translation of the word munajah. The Shaykh explained it further. He said munajah means the speech of a slave that is close to his Lord. In other words, this is a word that indicates the closeness of this interaction between the slave and his Lord. So when you enter into the salah, then you have entered into a state of closeness with Allah. And you have entered on Allah and you have stood before Allah.
ولهذا ينبغي علينا أن نشعر أن الصلاة موعد عظيم مع رب العالمين فنشتاق إليها. يقول عدي بن حاتم رضي الله عنه ما دخل وقت صلاة قط إلا وأنا مشتاق إليها.
It is for this reason that we should all seek to find yearning for the prayer and yearning for its times. Adi ibn Hatim, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, never has the time of prayer come upon me except that I was already in a state of longing or yearning for it.
وسئلت أمنا أم المؤمنين عائشة رضي الله عنها ما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يفعل في بيته، فقالت كان في مهنة أهله، هكذا كان صلى الله عليه وسلم متواضعا يخدم أهله. قالت فإذا نودي للصلاة وثب إليها، حتى هنا في رواية قالت وثب ما قالت قام، وثب يعني قام بسرعة وقوة ونشاط إلى الصلاة. هكذا ينبغي علينا أن نعظم هذه الصلاة.
And our mother, the mother of the believers, Aisha radiallahu anha, she was asked, what was the messenger up to at home? What would he be up to at home? What would he be found doing? So she said, radiallahu anha, that he would be in the service of his family. This is the description of our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was humble and helpful to his family at home. She said, However, if the call to the prayer was made, he would jump to it. Notice how in this particular narration, she said he would jump to it. She didn't say that he would get up to it. In other words, she's indicating his hastening to the prayer, the strength that was seen in his movement, and maybe perhaps the excitement that he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, displayed.
وإذا أصلحنا صلاتنا في الباطن بالخشوع، وكما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: الإحسان أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه، تصلي صلاة فيها الخشوع والقرب من الله تعالى، ثم تصلي في الظاهر كما صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اتباعا لسنته، هذه الصلاة ستصلح أعمالنا، كما قال ربنا جل وعلا: إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أول ما يحاسب به العبد من عمله يوم القيامة صلاته، فإن صلحت صلح سائر عمله، وإن فسدت فسد سائر عمله.
Shaykh Zahullah Allah Khairan, he said, if we rectify our prayers, beginning with the internal reality of that prayer, such that we pray with khushu', with humbleness to Allah, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, explaining what is al-ihsan, that you worship Allah as though you see him. Al-ihsan is to worship Allah as if you see him. So you pray recognizing that you are near to Allah, that Allah Azza wa Jal is watchful over you. And by also rectifying that which is apparent from the salah by mimicking the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray, then this prayer that we have rectified will rectify our deeds. Allah Jalla wa'ala said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Indeed, the prayer forbids from al-fahsha' wal-munkar, two categories of sin that Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned. The prayer forbids you and protects you from them. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the first of the deeds of a slave that he shall be held to account for is the prayer. And if the prayer is found to be sound, then the rest or the remainder of his deeds will be found sound.
إذن الصلاة تقوي إيمانك ومحبتك لله، وتقوي الصلة بينك وبين الله، فتبعدك عن الفحشاء والمنكر، عن المحرمات. كذلك الصلاة تثبت إيمانك، فإذا جاءت المصائب والفتن تثبت، كما قال الله تعالى: إن الإنسان خلق هلوعا. ما معنى هلوعا؟ قال الله تعالى يفسر هذه الكلمة: إذا مسه الشر جزوعا. هذه من طبيعة الإنسان، إذا أصابته مصيبة، أصابه الشر من فقر، من خسارة مال، من مرض، من موت قريب، قال إذا مسه الشر جزوعا، يجزع، لا يصبر، يتسخط على قدر الله. قال: وإذا مسه الخير منوعا، إذا جاءته نعمة أو مال يمنع الزكاة ويمنع الصدقة. هذه طبيعة فاسدة، يعني لا يصبر عند المصيبة ولا يشكر عند النعمة. قال: إلا المصلين الذين هم على صلاتهم دائمون. الذي يحافظ على الصلاة دائما، يكثر من الصلاة، الله تعالى ينزل عليه من السكينة عند المصائب وعند النعم بحسب ما في قلبه من الخشوع والطمأنينة في صلاته.
Shaykh Jazakallah Allah Khairan, he said, indeed, if you keep track of your prayers, you are observant of them, and mindful of establishing them properly, then Allah Jalla wa'ala will make this a reason for strengthening your bond, your connection to your Lord, reason for your love to Allah Azza wa Jalla to increase, the reason for remaining steadfast when calamities and trials strike, a reason to remain removed from sins and protected from falling into them. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He said, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا. Indeed, mankind has been created halu'. Sheikh said, what is the meaning of halu'? He said, Allah Jalla wa Ala explains it. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا. If evil touches him, he is jazu'. In other words, when something painful strikes at him, whether loss of wealth or being tested with an illness, a disease, or the death of a loved one, or the like, you find that he enters into a state of jaza. He has no patience. He enters into panic. He begins to show signs of extreme anxiety and worry. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. And if good happens to him, if good befalls him, then you find him withholding. يعني, if Allah Azza wa Jalla provides for him and suddenly he is given, he doesn't want to give charity, not even the obligatory zakah. شيخ جزاه الله خيرا explained, he said, هذه طبيعة فاسدة. This is a corrupt nature that is found in the human. Then Allah Azza wa Jal gave the exception. إِلَّا الْمُصَلِّينَ. Except for the people of prayer. الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَى صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. Those who are firm, permanent, steadfast upon their prayers. This is the nature of salah. It fixes you. And it makes you from those who are grateful when they are given, and patient and steadfast and firm when they are tested.
ولهذا ترون الكفار إذا أصابتهم المصائب يتسخطون يصرخون وفي نهاية الأمر ينتحرون. أكثر نسب الانتحار في العالم في بلاد الكفار. في اليابان ثاني دولة انتحار مع التقدم والتطور، لكن تأملوا لماذا لا يوجد إيمان. وهكذا في أمريكا أو غيرها من البلاد، لماذا ما توجد شجرة الإيمان عندهم؟ قطعوا صلتهم بالله، لا يصلون ولا عندهم إيمان في قلوبهم، فيريد أن يرتاح من هذا الشر فيقتل نفسه والعياذ بالله.
The Sheikh said, it is for this reason that you see that when the disbelievers are struck by trials, tested by tribulations, you see them complaining, you see them screaming, you see them enter into a state of great anxiety. And then finally, you see them taking their own lives, committing suicide. This is despite the fact that some of their countries are some of the most advanced countries, technologically speaking, scientifically speaking, in terms of the worldly amenities. However, these lands of the disbelievers are also, statistically speaking, the lands that show the greatest numbers, the greatest percentages of people committing suicide. Sheikh mentioned specifically Japan. I believe he mentioned it is number two. He said likewise America and other countries. Why is that? Sheikh said because they don't have this tree, the tree of faith. They have truncated, they have cut off, they have severed their connection with Allah Jalla wa Ala. So they seek rest, they seek comfort, they seek solace, they seek relief from these pains that they were tested and trialed with, and they find none. And the result, they take their own lives.
وإذا رأيت إلى حالهم في النعمة عندما يفتح الله لهم في الدنيا تراهم يتمتعون ويلعبون ويشربون الخمور ويقعون في الزنا، حتى تصل نسبة الزنا في هذه البلاد الغربية إلى 70% 80% من المجتمع والعياذ بالله، بل الذي لا توجد عنده صديقة يكون شاذا في المجتمع. فكما قال تعالى: إن هم إلا كالأنعام بل هم أضل سبيلا. إنسان لا يعرف ربه، لا يؤمن بالله الذي خلقه، ولا يعبده، ولا يصلي له، ولا يشكر له، لا تكون حياته طيبة أبدا، حياته تافهة. حتى البهيمة الحيوان أفضل منه، لأن الحيوان يسبح الله. إن هم إلا كالأنعام بل هم أضل سبيلا. فهذا كله يرجع إلى نعمة الإيمان، نحمد الله على هذه النعمة وهذه الشجرة، شجرة الإيمان التي في قلوبنا وفي حياتنا.
جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and if you ponder and examine their lives closely, these disbelievers, you see that they have enjoyed tremendous amenities from the amenities of this world. The creature comforts that they have all around them allow them to play and to enjoy themselves and to experience different pleasures. You also see them drinking liquors and fornicating. In fact, some statistics show that fornication has become so prevalent in their societies that up to 70 or perhaps 80% of the society has fallen into fornication. We ask Allah to grant us His refuge. Why? In fact, the Sheikh said, they have gotten to the point that a person who is not found to have a girlfriend, for example, is considered to be an oddity, to be weird, a person who does not engage in promiscuity, extramarital relationships, is found to be weird and strange and abnormal. It is exactly as Allah Jalla wa'ala described in Hum illa kal-an'am. They are nothing but akin to the an'am, the animals that Allah Jalla wa'ala has described as an'am, like cows, and so on and so forth. Then Allah said, بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا. Rather, they are more misguided. This disbeliever who does not recognize his Lord, does not know his Lord, does not show gratitude to his Lord, does not remember his Lord or make prayers to him, his life is not a good life. It's not a happy life. His life is actually trivial, devoid of meaning. He is like an animal. Rather, an animal is better than him, for at least the animal knows its Lord and is always making tasbih, glorifying Allah and exalting him, Jalla wa'ala. This is why Allah said, بَلْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا. Rather, they are more misguided, meaning even than the animal. We praise Allah for the blessing that He has granted us, the blessing of al-Iman, this tree that we have come to enjoy its fruits in this worldly life.
ولهذا انظروا إلى نعمة الإيمان على المؤمن. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: عجبا لأمر المؤمن، إن أمره كله له خير، وليس ذلك لأحد إلا للمؤمن. إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له، وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له. هذا من فضل الإيمان على المؤمن، في حال السراء والنعمة يشكر الله تعالى ويشكر نعمته ويعطي الفقراء والمساكين، فيكون حاله أحسن حال في النعمة. وكذلك في المصيبة يصبر ولا يتسخط ولا يعني يقدم على الانتحار وقتل نفسه، يصبر لأنه يؤمن بالله تعالى وبأن الله تعالى سيعطيه الأجر العظيم يوم القيامة.
الله إليكم شيخ، جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and wondrous is the affair of the believer. Ponder over the affair of the believer. The messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, عجبا لأمر المؤمن. Wondrous is the affair of the believer. Indeed, all his affairs are good for him. That is for no one but the believer. And then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he broke it down. إن أصابته سراء شكر. فكان خيرا له. If good befalls him, he shows gratitude. And that is better for him. So when Allah gives him, he does not withhold. He is generous. He gives. He is not harmed by the gifts of Allah تبارك وتعالى. He reacts to them properly. وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له. And if harm befalls him, he shows patience. And that is better for him. He does not lament and become anxious and depressed. He does not start thinking about harming himself and commit suicide. This is from the blessing of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that He bestows upon those who have al-Iman.
وأذكر لكم قصة حصلت لي. سافرت مرة إلى ألمانيا لعلاج أحد الأولاد رحمه الله تعالى. فهناك في القسم توجد طبيبة متخصصة في علم النفس فقط، حتى وظيفتها في ذلك القسم حتى تخفف على الآباء والأمهات، لأن هذا القسم يحصل فيه موت كثير للأطفال بسبب يعني شدة المرض مثل السرطانات وغيرها من الأمراض. فوظيفتها أنها تخفف الألم النفسي عن الآباء والأمهات. فأذكر أنها عندما جاءت تكلمنا تقول يعني الولد ما يعيش وكذا، ممكن يعيش سنة ويموت، وهذا حصل يعني قدر الله الحمد لله على كل حال. لكن قالت لي يعني نحن لما تخبرنا بهذا الخبر نقول الحمد لله، يعني الحمد لله كله خير، قدر الله كله خير والأمر بيد الله. فتقول لي أنا أستغرب منكم أنتم المسلمون، يعني عندما أخبركم بهذا الخبر العصيب الشديد يعني أجد عليكم الطمأنينة والسكينة وتحمدون الله. وتقول هذا أصعب ما يكون عندما أخبر يعني الأب أو الأم يعني الأسرة الكافرة. قل ما أدري ماذا أقول إذا قلت لهم ولدكم سيموت، ف يعني ما يمكن أن يقبلوا هذا، وكثير منهم يصرخ ويعني ممكن يسيء إلي بالكلام وكذا. فسبحان الله قلت له هذا كله من فضل الإيمان، يعني هذه ثمرة الإيمان وأثر الإيمان على الإنسان.
الحمد لله. شيخ جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and I want to share a story that happened with me related to this affair. I had traveled to Germany in order to get treatment for one of my children. May Allah have mercy upon him. And right in that department in the hospital where he was being treated, there is a doctor, a specialist in psychology. Her only job in that department is to offer emotional assistance and help, psychiatric help, for the families, emotional support for the families of the children that are admitted into that department. Because it is known in that particular department that there's a lot of cases that do not recover and end up in the death of the child. Things like cancer and so on. Sheikh said, her job is to help remove or relieve some of the pain that the families experience when the news first comes to them. So when she came to speak to us, she told us that this child is not expected to live but a single year. There's only 1 year perhaps left in the life of this child. And this is exactly what happened, actually. Allah Jalla wa'ala had decreed, and all praises to him, that this child will not live. Sheikh said that she said to us, yani when she saw our reaction was when she told us that we said, Alhamdulillah, the decree of Allah is nothing but good. She said to us, I am amazed by you. I'm surprised by you. You show such tranquility and you show such calmness. You praise Allah. You are Muslims and your reaction is so different. When it's time to tell a non-Muslim family the same thing, it is one of the most difficult situations in my job. And I don't even know what to tell them. Some of them break down, some of them start screaming, and some of them even start to harm me. So the Sheikh said, I answered and I said, this is the fruit of al-Iman, samaratu al-Iman. That it is the reason that Allah bestows such tranquility and peace upon His slave.
فالصبر عند المصيبة هذا يسقي شجرة الإيمان ويقويها، تكون الشجرة ثابتة. قال الله تعالى: ما أصاب من مصيبة إلا بإذن الله، ومن يؤمن بالله يهدي قلبه. من يؤمن بالله، أنت مؤمن، لكن عند المصيبة تحتاج إلى أن تجدد إيمانك، يعني تتذكر أن الله هو الذي قدر كل شيء، وأن الله عليم بحالك، وأن الله هو الحكيم فيما يقدر ويفعل، وأن الله أرحم بعباد من الوالدة بولدها. فإذا تذكرت قدر الله وعلمه وحكمته ورحمته، قال الله تعالى: ومن يؤمن بالله يهدي قلبه، تشعر بالرضا والطمأنينة في قلبك. نعم.
جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and this patience that the believer experiences at the time of trials and tribulations and tests is itself nourishment for his faith. Allah Jalla wa Ala said, ما أصاب من مصيبة إلا بإذن الله. Never does a trial befall her except that it is by the permission of Allah. Then Allah said, وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ يَهْدِي قَلْبَهُ. And whoever believes in Allah, then Allah will guide his heart. In other words, we are being taught to revive and renew and put into practice our faith. At the time of calamity, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most knowledgeable of your affair, that Allah Jalla wa Ala is most wise in what He has decreed and decided in your affair, that Allah Tabaraka fi Ula is more merciful to you than your mother. Allah is more merciful to His slaves than their mothers. This is a revival of faith, and this is what Allah Jalla wa Ala promised. If you believe in Allah, من يؤمن بالله يهدي قلبه, Allah will guide his heart. Allah will then bestow tranquility and peace upon you, and He will help you through the difficulty of that trial, of that tribulation.
وهذه الشجرة شجرة الإيمان تسقيها بالأعمال الصالحة. ذكرنا الصلاة والصبر عند المصيبة والشكر عند النعم، وهكذا كل عمل صالح، الإكثار من ذكر الله تعالى هذا يجدد الإيمان. قال الله تعالى: ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب. ولهذا يقول ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما في هذه الآية في شجرة الإيمان: تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها، قال هو المؤمن يذكر ربه بكرة وعشية، يذكر رب على كل حال، كما كان نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم يذكر الله في كل أحيانه. فكلما ذكرت الله تحرك الإيمان في قلبك وتجدد ونمى وزاد الإيمان في قلبك.
جزاه الله خيرا. يسأل: We had mentioned that these good deeds are the nourishment on the tree of faith. And from the good deeds that we have given as examples is as-salah. Likewise, showing gratitude to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala at the times of ease and receiving amenities and blessings from Him. Likewise, showing patience when it is the time of trial and tribulation and testing. And from the greatest of good deeds in terms of its effect on the faith is to remember Allah abundantly. Allah Jalla wa Ala said, Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. Oh, indeed, it is through the remembrance of Allah that the hearts find tranquility. Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with the both of them, he said, commenting on this ayah, the ayah about the tree of faith, he said, this is the believer. He mentions his Lord in the early part of the day and in the latter part of the day. This is exactly, the Shaykh comments, the affair of our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to be always engaged in the remembrance of Allah, always mentioning his Lord, tabarak wa ta'ala. This is a revival of your faith. Every time you mention Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala, it enlivens your faith. It shines its lights. It renews it and increases it and causes it to grow.
وهكذا كل عمل صالح يزيدك إيمانا، من قيام الليل، من صيام النهار، من بر الوالدين، من الإحسان إلى الفقراء والمساكين. وهكذا على كل واحد منا أن يجتهد في الأعمال الصالحة. ولهذا تأمل كيف يصف الله تعالى المؤمنين في القرآن بالأعمال الصالحة: قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون. تأمل كيف بدأ بالصلاة كما بدأنا بها: والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون، والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون، والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون، إلى آخر الآيات. وهكذا يصف الله المؤمنين بالأعمال الصالحة.
Shaykh Jazakallah الله خيرا. He said, and likewise, every good deed is a nourishment of the faith. The night prayers, the fasting in the daytime, the kindness and good treatment of one's parents, the generosity to the poor and the needy. It is befitting for each one of us to strive in the pursuit of good deeds. And this is how Allah Azza wa Jal has described the people of the faith. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He mentioned in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Indeed, the believers have succeeded. And what was the description of المؤمنون? Allah Jalla wa Ala began these descriptions by saying, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who are humble, يعني to Allah, in their prayers. Allah Jalla wa Ala began their descriptions with the prayer, just as we have began with the prayer. Then Allah said, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. And those who are turning away from, disinterested in اللغو. اللغو is every type of empty speech or pointless action, to the end of these ayat that show the good deeds that the mu'minun engage in.
ثم أيضا الأمر الآخر الذي يسقي هذه الشجرة العلم النافع. فإذا نجتهد في العمل الصالح والعلم النافع. فالعلم من أعظم أسباب زيادة الإيمان، وأعظم علم العلم بالقرآن الكريم. ولذلك أنا أنصح إخواني وأخواتي أن يتعلموا القرآن، ومفتاح تعلم القرآن الكريم تعلم اللغة العربية. فأنا أقول لإخواني وأخواتي من الذين لا ينطقون باللغة العربية، تعلموا اللغة العربية، اللغة العربية تزيدكم إيمانا. اللغة العربية بها تذوقون حلاوة القرآن الكريم، وهي أجمل لغة وأسهل لغة والحمد لله. فإذا تعلمتم اللغة ستتعلمون القرآن حق تعلمه، ستتذوقون حلاوة القرآن. تأملوا كيف أن القرآن يزيد في الإيمان. الله يقول إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم. بمجرد أن تسمع اسم الله تشعر في قلبك بمحبة وهيبة وتعظيم. قال وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. كلما سمعت آيات القرآن تزداد إيمانا، لأن القرآن يجمع كل العلوم الإيمانية والحقائق الإلهية. فكلما تتعلم القرآن تزداد إيمانا يوما بعد يوم.
الله إليكم. شيخ جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and the other thing that grows the faith and causes it to increase is beneficial knowledge. We mentioned the righteous actions and likewise the beneficial knowledge. Allah Jalla wa'ala has made it from the greatest of reasons by which the faith is attained and nourished and grows is the beneficial knowledge. And the greatest of all knowledge is knowledge of the Quran. For this reason, I advise all of you to learn the Quran. It is the key to increasing your faith, growing it, affirming it. And the key to learning the Quran as you truly ought to, is learning the Arabic language. I'm advising all my brothers and sisters who do not speak Arabic to learn the Arabic language. The Arabic language will increase you in Iman, will increase you in faith, will allow you to taste the sweetness of the Quran. It will allow you to truly benefit from the Quran. The Arabic language is the most beautiful language. And it is the easiest language. If you learn it, you will taste the sweetness of the Book of Allah, Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He said, لَمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Surely the believers are none but those who, when Allah Azza wa Jalla is mentioned, their hearts enter into a state of wajal. The Shaykh explains, he said, just the mere mention of Allah, His name, will cause the love to stir in your heart, the fear of Allah and glorifying of Him to stir in your heart. And then Allah Jalla wa Ala said, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. And if His verses are recited upon them, it increases them in faith. With the Arabic language, you will become from these people. Every time you hear the Quran, it increases you in faith. The Quran is the source of all knowledge. The Quran is the foundation of the types of knowledge that affect the faith, of the realities of the divine.
ولهذا يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه.
It is for this reason that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the best of you are those who learn the Quran and teach it.
وهكذا المسلم إذا تعلم العلم النافع، يتعلم القرآن، يتعلم سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، يتعلم أركان الإيمان، ويتعلم أسماء الله وصفاته. تخيل أنك تقف مع كل اسم من أسماء الله الحسنى، وكلما عرفت ربك ازددت محبة لله وخشية لله، تتعلم سيرة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فتزداد حبا للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم واتباعا له، تقرأ قصص الأنبياء في القرآن الكريم، وهكذا تتعلم العلوم النافعة، فيكون في قلبك زيادة إيمان وخشية لله، كما قال الله تعالى: إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. يعني العلماء أشد الناس خشية لله تعالى، لأنهم عرفوا من عظمة الله وكماله وإحسانه ما لا يعرفه كثير من الناس.
جزاه الله خيرا. He said, likewise, you learn the beneficial knowledge, you learn the Quran, and you learn the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, you learn the pillars of the faith, you learn the names of Allah and His attributes. Imagine that you actually take time to start with every single name of Allah, learn it and ponder over it and benefit from it. This will cause you to grow your love for Allah, and to grow your fear of Allah. And likewise, learn the prophetic seerah, the biography, the days and times of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This will cause you to increase in love for him, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, and also increase in the amount of adherence and following that you show to his sunnah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Likewise, the stories of the prophets, every knowledge that is beneficial, this will cause your faith to grow and cause your fear of Allah to grow. For Allah عز وجل has said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. Indeed, none fear Allah from his slaves except for the scholars. The scholars are the ones who have the true, the real fear of Allah. Fear that is based on knowledge. Knowledge of Allah's glory, of Allah's majesty, of Allah's greatness, of Allah's supremacy. Baraka fi ula.
ثم إذا سقينا شجرة الإيمان بالعلم النافع والعمل الصالح، تقوى جذور الشجرة في قلوبنا بمحبة الله وتعظيمه وخشيته، ثم تقوى فروعها في السماء بالأعمال الصالحة، وتؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها. ثمرت هذه الشجرة بذكر الله، الذكر الدائم لله وبالأخلاق الحسنة. هذه من ثمار الإيمان، الأخلاق الحسنة. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: إن المؤمن ليدرك بحسن خلقه درجة الصائم القائم. فالإيمان يثمر الأخلاق الحسنة والصفات الجميلة للمؤمن، هذه من الإيمان في الحقيقة ومن ثمرات الإيمان. وهذه الأخلاق الطيبة من أعظم أسباب الدعوة إلى الإسلام، لا سيما في بلادكم، عندما تتخلق بالأخلاق الطيبة، بالتواضع، بالإحسان، فهذا مما يؤلف قلوب الكفار للإسلام بإذن الله تعالى.
الله يبارك. جزاه الله خيرا. He said, so if we nourish the tree of Iman with beneficial knowledge and righteous actions, the roots of this tree will strengthen, will grow. The roots of Tawheed, sincerity, the love of Allah and fear of Him. Likewise, its branches will strengthen, the branches of good deeds and righteous actions. And it will begin bearing its fruits all times by the permission of its Lord. Fruits such as frequent remembrance of Allah and the improvement of one's character and mannerisms. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, indeed the believer will reach through his good manners the level of the person who is fasting by day and praying the night prayers by night. All of this is reached by his good manners. So good manners is from the faith, and likewise it is from the fruits of faith. These good manners, from the greatest of the means by which we call to Allah and spread Islam. With these good manners, such as humbleness, such as graciousness, kindness, are from the greatest of means by which we attract the hearts of the disbelievers and call them to Islam.
ولهذا تأملوا في نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم عندما فتح الله تعالى له مكة واجتمع الكفار وينتظرون ماذا سيفعل بهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فقال: ما تظنون أني فاعل بكم؟ قالوا: أخ كريم وابن أخ كريم. قال: اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. هؤلاء الذين آذوه في بداية الدعوة وسبوه وطردوه من بلده حتى هاجر إلى المدينة، وحاربوه بعد ذلك، كسروا رباعيته يعني أسنانه الأمامية، وشجوا وجهه، مع ذلك يعفو عنهم. أمام هذا العفو ما كان منهم إلا أن دخلوا في دين الله أفواجا، أسلموا لله تعالى بسبب الأخلاق الحسنة التي هي من أعظم صفات المؤمنين، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أكمل المؤمنين إيمانا أحسنهم خلقا.
الشيخ said, جزاه الله خيرا. Ponder the affair of your messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he returned to Mecca as a conqueror. And when Allah Azza wa Jalla had given him the victory over the disbelievers in Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked them, what do you think I'm going to do to you? And they said, you are a noble brother and the son of a noble brother. In other words, they were trying to get the Prophet ﷺ to forgive them. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, true to their expectations, اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. Go ahead, for indeed you are the freed, or you are the forgiven. So what was their reaction to his forgiveness, his good manners? What was their reaction given the history? They had harmed him. They had attacked him. They had spoken ill of him. They had forced him to flee. They banished him from his home, from his hometown. And he was forced to migrate to Medina, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not only that, but then they pursued him with further harm. They went to war against him. They broke one of his front teeth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they injured him in his cheek, in his face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To other than that, from the great harm that has reached him from them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the face of all of that, what was the reaction? اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. So what was their reaction when they saw this great forgiveness, this great manner from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They entered into the deen of Allah afwaja, in droves, in groups. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlights the importance of these manners. He says, أكمل المؤمنين إيمانا أحسنهم أخلاقا. Most complete of the believers in faith are those who have the best of manners.
ثم الأمر الثاني الذي يجعل الشجرة، شجرة الإيمان، قوية بعد أن سقينا الشجرة بالعلم النافع والعمل الصالح، الأمر الثاني علينا أن نحفظ الشجرة من ما يضرها، كما أن المزارع يحفظ الشجرة من النباتات الضارة والحشرات المؤذية، فكذلك المؤمن يحفظ إيمانه مما يضره، والذي يضره في الحقيقة المعاصي والمحرمات.
جزاه الله خيرا. He said, The second affair that we have to pay attention to after having nourished this tree with beneficial knowledge and righteous actions is to protect it from harms. Just like a farmer protects his crops, his trees, from harmful vegetation, from harmful insects and parasites. The believer has to protect his faith from that which harms it. And the harms in reality are sin and transgression.
ولهذا لا تستهن، لا تستصغر أي معصية، لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: إن العبد إذا أذنب ذنبا نكت في قلبه نكتة سوداء، يعني كل معصية نقطة سوداء في قلبك. لا تقل هذه نظرة إلى الحرام تنظر إلى امرأة متبرجة، أو هذه كلمة غيبة، أو هذه نومة عن الصلاة، أو المرأة تخرج مثلا بدون حجاب أو ينكشف شيء من عورتها تتساهل في هذا، لا تتساهل في المحرمات، كل معصية فهي نقطة سوداء في قلبك. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: فإذا تاب ونزع واستغفر صقل قلبه. فعلينا نجدد التوبة والاستغفار دائما. قال: وإذا زاد عادت، أو إذا عاد، نعم، إذا عاد إلى المعاصي زادت هذه النقط حتى تعلو قلبه، يعني تغطي قلبه. قال: فذلك الران، يعني الغطاء على القلب. وقرأ قول الله تعالى: كلا بل ران على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون، يعني غطى قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون من المعاصي. فإذا كان هذا الغطاء على القلب هكذا يقسو القلب ويموت القلب، فتموت شجرة الإيمان.
جزاه الله خير حسن. So we say, do not look down upon any sin. Do not underestimate the effects of sins, although they may appear to be small. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, if a slave commits a sin, a single black dot is placed on his heart. Don't say this is just a casual glance, for example, at a woman that is not covered properly. Don't say this is just a brief comment I made, perhaps backbiting someone. Don't say this is just one prayer that I've decided to skip on so that I could get more sleep. Or the sisters, don't say that, you know, this is just a little something that I haven't covered properly from that which is obligatory to cover, and she goes outside with this, or even goes outside without hijab. Rather, remember that every single sin is a black spot to be placed on the heart. Prophet ﷺ continues and he says, and if he repents and leaves it and seeks forgiveness, yani from Allah, his heart will be polished. His heart will be polished. So renew and revive your repentance to Allah and seek his forgiveness. And the Prophet ﷺ then said, and if he returns, yani to the sin, إذا عاد زادت. And if he returns to the sin, this blackness, it increases. He said, حتى تعلو قلبه, until it covers his heart. And then he said, فذلك الران. And that is what Allah described, يعني meaning in the Quran, as الران. And he recited, صلى الله عليه وسلم, كلا بل ران على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون. The Sheikh explained, he said, الران, meaning الغطاء, meaning a cover. This is what Allah جل وعلا referred to. No, rather, it is what they used to do. It covered their hearts, that concealed their hearts, that took hold of their hearts. The heart will then harden. The faith will weaken, and the tree of Iman will die.
كذلك يبتعد المسلم عن اللغو، يعني أي شيء لا ينفعك من القيل والقال، يعني الكلام الذي لا ينفع. ولهذا يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت. وهكذا من المجالس التي ليس فيها نفع، فيها المحرمات من كثرة اللعب واللهو، فابتعد عن اللغو. هذا أيضا مما يحفظ لك إيمانك. ولهذا قال تعالى: قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون، ثم قال: والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون. إذا أعرضت عن كل ما لا ينفعك، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من حسن إسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه. حسن الإسلام هذا قوة الإيمان، أن يترك كل ما لا ينفعه يوم القيامة عند الله. فهذا يجعلك تستغل وقتك في ما ينفعك من صلاة، من علم، من ذكر لله، من تلاوة للقرآن، فهذا الذي
السلام عليكم
سينفعك، هذا سيزيد
فضيلة الشيخ.
إيمان. نعم
هل
تفضل.
يمكن أن تعيدوا هذا الجزء؟ لأنه كان عندي شيء من العطل الفني.
أيوة طيب، مرة أخرى: كذلك مما يقوي شجرة الإيمان، كما تبتعد عن المعاصي كذلك تبتعد عن اللغو. ولهذا يقول الله تعالى: قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون. واللغو كل شيء لا ينفعك عند الله يوم القيامة، من الكلام الذي لا ينفع قيل والقال. لهذا يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت. هذا من كمال الإيمان. ويقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من حسن إسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه، تترك كل ما لا ينفعك من الكلام، من النظر، من اللعب واللهو، يعني الإكثار في ذلك. وهكذا تستغل أوقاتك في العلم النافع، في تدبر القرآن، تعلم التفسير، تعلم الحديث، تعلم العلم النافع من والعمل الصالح من الصلاة والذكر كما ذكرنا. فإذا ابتعدت عن اللغو هذا يجعلك تستغل وقتك في ما ينفعك، وهذا يقوي إيمانك.
أحسن الله إليكم الشيخ، جزاه الله خيرا. He said likewise, after having refrained from sin and staying away from sin, to stay away from what is defined or termed اللغو. اللغو that Allah mentioned in the Quran in His statement when He talked about the believers. Indeed, the believers have succeeded. قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون. Those who are humble in their prayers, يعني to their Lord. Allah immediately mentioned after that, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ, and those who turn away from اللَّغْوِ. The Shaykh explains what is اللَّغْوِ. He says, everything that does not benefit you on the Day of Judgment is اللَّغْوِ. For example, speech that does not count in your good deeds with Allah is اللَّغْوِ. For example, he said, she said, and the like of that. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawmil akhir falyaqul shay'an aw liyasmut." Whoever believes in Allah on the final day, let him say good or remain silent. Let him say good or remain silent. This is for who? For those who believe in Allah on the final day. This is a matter of the faith. This is completion and perfection of the faith. He also said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Min husni islam al-mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'nihi." From the beautification of a man's Islam is to leave off that which doesn't concern him. Whether it is speech in something that doesn't concern you, whether it is looking at something that does not concern you, or playing, and you know, for example, excessive playing, thus wasting time, meaning that it does not concern you, all of these things will take from your time. Instead, you should invest your time. Take advantage of it. Take advantage of your time to pursue beneficial knowledge, to ponder over the Quran, to learn, for example, التفسير, the tafsir of the Book of Allah. Likewise, to pursue righteous actions, to stay away from lahu, basically means to recapture your time, recapture your opportunity to invest in that which grows your iman and protects it.
نعم، وأنا سامحوني على الإطالة، لكن يعني نختم إذن هذه المحاضرة بالأمر الذي يثبت هذه الشجرة في قلوبنا في حياتنا، مع العلم النافع والعمل الصالح كما عرفنا هذا يسقي الشجرة، ثم البعد عن المحرمات واللغو هذا يحفظ قوة الشجرة. ففي النهاية هذه الشجرة إنما يعني الإيمان فضل من الله تعالى ونعمة من الله تعالى، وعلينا دائما أن ندعو الله تعالى أن يثبتنا على الإيمان، كما قال الله تعالى عن الراسخين في العلم، قال ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. و جاء في الحديث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال إن الإيمان لا يخلق في جوف أحدكم، يعني يصبح قديما في القلب، يعني ضعيفا، كما يخلق الثوب، كما يصبح الثوب قديما ضعيفا. قال فاسألوا الله أن يجدد الإيمان في قلوبكم، فنسأل الله تعالى أن يجدد الإيمان في قلوبنا ونقوي شجرة الإيمان في قلوبنا.
اللهم آمين. جزاه الله خيرا. He is to be pardoned for the length of this lecture. And he said we conclude with mentioning that which keeps the faith firm in our hearts, that which keeps this tree firm in our hearts. He said we spoke about that which nourishes it, causes it to grow, and that is beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. We also spoke about protecting it from harmful vegetation or parasites and the like, and that is to stay away from sin, amongst the other things we mentioned. And now we conclude by mentioning that which preserves it, protects it, and keeps it firm. And that is to remember that this is purely the gift of Allah. Fadlullah Jalla wa Ala. So it is upon us to call upon Him, to ask Allah, to make dua, asking Allah Jalla wa Ala to keep the iman firm in our hearts. It is the dua of those who are firmly planted in knowledge, that they used to say, رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَّابُ. O our Lord, do not deviate our hearts after you have guided us. Grant us mercy from yourself. Indeed, you are the one to often grant. And likewise, our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Inna al-imana la yakhlaqu fi jawfi ahadikum kama yakhlaqu al-thawb." Indeed, the faith wears out, wears thin, inside the chest of one of you, just as a garment would wear out, would wear thin. So ask Allah to revive, to renew the faith in your hearts. Or as he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Shaykh concluded by making dua. He said, so we ask Allah to renew the faith in our hearts. And we ask Allah to make strong and make firm the tree of iman in our hearts.
وبعد أن ذكر الله تعالى شجرة الإيمان في سورة إبراهيم، قال بعد هذه الآية يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ويضل الله الظالمين ويفعل الله ما يشاء. يعني إذا كانت شجرة الإيمان قوية بجذورها في قلبك وأغصانها وفروعها عالية في السماء، فأعمالك الصالحة دائما ترفع إلى الله تعالى في السماء، وثمار الإيمان مستمرة تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها، تكون على ذكر دائم، وأخلاقك طيبة مع كل الناس. إذا كانت هذه الشجرة قوية ثابتة، الله تعالى يثبتك في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة، يثبتك في قبرك إذا دفنت في القبر وسئلت أسئلة القبر، من ربك؟ ما دينك؟ من نبيك؟ قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فهنا يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. ثم غدا تثبت قدمك على الصراط، وهذا الصراط الذي هو على نار جهنم، وهو أدق من الشعر، لكن الله تعالى يثبت المؤمنين ويمر المؤمن عليه، تتفاوت سرعة المؤمنين بحسب تفاوت إيمانهم، فكلما كان إيمانك قويا كان مرورك سريعا، تمر كالبرق أو كالريح. فنسأل الله أن يثبتنا في الدنيا والآخرة، نسأل الله تعالى أن يقوي إيماننا وأن يثبتنا على الإيمان حتى نلقاه، وأن يتوفانا مؤمنين مسلمين، والحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
الله عليكم فضيلة الشيخ، وشكر الله سعيكم وجزاكم عنا وعن سائر إخواننا خير الجزاء. نسأل الله يتقبل منكم هذه الكلمة، وإن شاء الله نترجم الآن المقطع الأخير. يا جزاه الله خيرا. He said, and ponder what Allah جل وعلا said in Surah Ibrahim after he mentioned the tree of faith. Allah جل وعلا then mentioned, يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة، ويضل الله الظالمين. Allah makes firm those who have believed with the firm speech in the worldly life and in the hereafter. And Allah misguides the transgressors. In other words, if you have nourished this tree and you have caused it to grow and you have worked on its roots of Iman, Tawheed, Ikhlas, loving Allah, beneficial knowledge and righteous actions, if you protected it from parasites and you've called upon Allah, asking Him to preserve it and revive it, and you've done all of these steps, then expect Allah Jalla wa Ala, just as He has given you the fruits of that tree, the fruits of righteous actions that continue to ascend to Allah, the fruits of continuous remembrance of Allah, and the fruits of good manners that you share with all, you share with all people. Expect Allah also grant you firmness when you are entered into your grave. Bil akhirah, in the hereafter, means when you enter your grave and you are asked, Man Rabbu, Ma Deenu, Man Hadha Rajul, Ladhi Bu'itha Feekum, when you're asked, who is your Lord? What is your religion? Who is this man that was sent amongst you? That you will answer correctly, because Allah will give you firmness. Allah will guide you to answer correctly. And then you will also be given firmness tomorrow on the Day of Judgment, when the Sirat, the bridge, is placed over Jahannam. The Sirat that is thinner than a hair. Allah Jalla wa Ala will be the one to give you firm steps upon it. The believers will be firmed up by Allah to be able to cross this dangerous bridge. And they will be given the ability to cross according to their iman, according to their faith. So how much you invest in your faith in this dunya is how much you will be given the ability to cross that bridge. And the speed varies by iman. Some of them will cross so quickly, it will be like the strike of lightning, and some like the blowing of the wind. So we ask Allah, the Shaykh concluded, to grant us to die upon Islam, to die upon Iman. And the Shaykh made many beneficial and great du'as. For all of that, we say Ameen. And we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to reward the Shaykh tremendously for the time and effort that he has expended with us tonight, sharing his knowledge, advising us, and admonishing us. We ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to make this beneficial for all of us and for all those who hear it to the end of time. Wa sallallahu sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Shakar Allahu sa'i shaykhina wa taqabbala minhu bi qabulin hasan wa 'azzama an-naf'a bima yaqulu wa yad'u ilayhi.
جزاكم الله خيرا، بارك الله فيكم.
وإياكم شيخنا، الله إليكم.